outdoor. Thanks so much for having me here. And over the last weekend, we've had our Matariki Hui at Earthsong. So one weekend a year, we come together and spend the whole weekend together working, playing, doing all sorts of, you know, feasting, partying, doing a lot of things. And this time, actually, we spent a bit of time talking about Wairua and what that actually really means. And I just have the sense there's a lot of Wairua in the room tonight, actually. I feel a bit sort of emotional about it. It's really lovely. So thank you so much for having me here to talk to you. Is the sound okay? You can hear okay? Yeah. I might cough a little bit because I'm still actually recovering from a cold I had a month ago, so it's not COVID as far as I know. but my voice might start running out, so it's really good to have a microphone. So, just to introduce myself a little bit. I have an architecture background, so I studied architecture at Auckland University and designed single sort of eco-friendly houses for a number of years, and then really just thought, what is most important, you know, in this time, and what's the best use I can make of that? And that's when I started on the Earthsong journey, because I had two children, a 10-year-old and a 6-year-old at that point, and really, really wanted them to grow up in community, actually, and felt that with that architecture background, I had a whole range of skills which would be really helpful. So that was back in, 1995, actually, we started the Earthsong project. And through that development, I wasn't the architect. So a lot of people say Robin Allison, the architect of Earthsong. I wasn't the architect, actually, but I was the project manager, sort of development coordinator of that project through all of that sort of 10, 12 year development period. So I just want to talk a little bit about the time that we're in now, in Aotearoa, on the planet. I mean, I think it's just impossible to ignore now that we really are at a moment of change, or a time of change, and we have a lot of choices that we can make about whether we carry on the same way that we have been and expect the world to carry on, or actually whether we need to make some radical changes. And I think it's everything that I see really just reinforces how interconnected we are on this planet, that actually the choices that we each make have an impact on the health of a whole lot of other species, a lot of other people, on our climate, etc. And so I like this slide because it really reminds me of how interconnected we are and how our choices matter. And, you know, and when you're talking buildings, they last for a long time, you know, 50 years or more, 100 years. And so the choices we make now have implications well into the future. So I just think it's really, really important that everyone we in this room think about the kinds of lives we want to lead and what are the housing situations that will help support that in terms of our individual kind of flourishing, and also in terms of how we can learn to be good neighbours to the rest of the planet, the other species, the systems, etc. So I just think that this is the time when it's so critical that we have the opportunity, you know, we have skills and opportunities to create different kinds of housing, and I really encourage everyone to think hard about what is a flourishing life, a flourishing housing situation for yourselves and your family and for everyone else and for the other species of the planet, and what does that look like and how can we make that happen. So when I did that that sort of thinking back in the early 90s, and I came across a book called Cohousing that really described for me the kind of community that I wanted. And it was from that moment that I started working towards putting that into practice and building a cohousing community. So I'm going to describe just a little bit about Earthsong, not go into any great detail, but just to set the scene really for some of the other things. So Earthsong is a 32-home co-housing community in Rānui in West Auckland, on 3 acres of land, 1.2 hectares. So 32 houses and common facilities. This is our common house here. You can just see the roof of it in the background there. And we're in the suburbs, so we're not rural, we're not central city, we're suburban, and are surrounded by suburban neighbours. And we started off in the early days, which as I said was really 1995, is when we date our beginning from, getting really clear about what it was we were wanting to do and writing a one-sentence vision statement about what was the kind of underlying purpose for what we wanted to do, what were the key things. And for us, it basically had three equal legs of a stool. So one of them was environmental sustainability, and that's about the buildings and the site layout and the services and the permaculture systems, etc. So just seeing how far we could go to build and live in a housing situation that was as environmentally sustainable as possible. The second one, equal with the environmental, was social sustainability, and I'll talk in a minute a bit more about what that might mean. And the third one was a real commitment to sharing whatever we learned that could be of help to other people so that we were part of helping to move our society, if you like, towards more sustainable housing. It wasn't just a lovely place for us to live and you know, have a lovely life. There was a real commitment right from the beginning to being part of the solution, if you like, to sharing what we learnt to be of service. And so that's partly why I wrote the book. It's why we have tours of Earthsong all the time and enormous amount of information on our website. If you've ever looked up our website, we've shared whatever we thought might be helpful to other people. So those were the three main sort of commitments, I guess, that we made right from the beginning. So I'm just very quickly going to describe those three things. So environmental sustainability, a lot of it is to do with how we've designed the site. So this is the Earthsong site. This is Swanson Road, which is our quite busy road that comes past. North is off to the left, which is important, you know, absolutely critical actually to this site layout when you're trying to design energy efficient houses. So I'm probably going to get in the way of this. So there's a driveway which comes down. One of the main site features is that we keep all the cars at the edge of the site, so behind there and all the way along that boundary are where the car parks are, and that's where the cars stop. People get out of their cars and the rest of the community is all pedestrian. So there's the main path which winds through the middle of the site in a figure eight, looping through the middle, and off that main path come smaller paths leading to clusters of houses. So that's four houses and three houses around that path. This is six houses here around that path. So there's lots of design elements in there that make it work both environmentally and socially. One of the things is that you're not kind of one single house in 32 houses. Actually, you are a single house in a bunch of six houses in a bunch of 32 houses. So it's building in layers, which really makes it so much easier to get to know your neighbours, to sort of feel, you know, you belong, to make choices about where you want to be. So I said north's off to the left, so every house has a north face of their house, so that the sun can come into the house, warm the concrete floor and the rammed earth walls, and keep those houses really warm in winter. What else? Every cluster has a water tank, so the roof water from those seven houses goes into that tank and then back to those seven houses. We have our overland, this is our common house, by the way, at the sort of focal point of the site, around the common green, and the blue line is our swale system. So basically the land naturally fell sort of in from the edges into the middle, so low point through the middle, and from the south down to the north. So we just worked with that in terms of where we put the houses and how we've coped with the overland rainwater, stormwater flows. So it flows into a swale beside every path and beside that path through the middle. So a swale is a wide, shallow trench where the water flows overland through water-loving plants like watercress and bananas and all sorts of plants planted in that swale, and it has time to soak back into the ground, etc. And so by the time the flow gets down to the pond at the north end, there's very much less water than there would be if it was a, you know, a concrete channel or a pipe.
And it's clean.
And there's ducks, yeah, and frogs. So that's just very briefly, yeah, outlining some of the environmental aspects that we thought of when we were designing. I guess also to say that the houses are all rammed earth, have rammed earth walls and untreated timber, a lot of untreated timber, solid timber, no MDFs, no particle board whatsoever, no, you know, absolutely minimal blues, etc., etc. So a lot of effort put into the materials that we use and choosing the most eco-friendly, non-toxic, you know, low-energy materials that we could. So then we come to social sustainability, and, you know, what does that mean? It can mean lots of things to lots of different people, really, but I guess the things that we think of when we talk about social sustainability are things like respectful communication between us, a sense of belonging, that every person belongs in this community and has an equal say in the governance. So consensus decision making is part of that. It's a real sort of safety and security of knowing your neighbours, knowing, you know, recognising voices on the path at night and knowing, you know, not knowing who they are. A real intergenerational life, so we've always valued diversity in age, in socioeconomic status, in ethnicity, you know, as much diversity as we can. And yeah, it just builds a rich life, really, because in terms of age, for instance, it can be hard work having children in a nuclear household, you know, mum, dad, and or even often a single parent and kids. It doesn't have to be that hard. You know, kids used to be raised in villages, in community, where there were other people around to take some of the load when it was needed. And so the kids that grow up at Earthsong have, you know, they're a bit of a tribe. They have a lot of fun together. Sometimes they have, you know, arguments and need a wee bit of sorting out. But there's lots of adults who know them, and there's lots of there's older people also who have more time often than younger people, but need a bit more support in the garden or whatever it is. The synergies between them work really well. And the kids that live at Earthsong are just so much more socialised and confident, and I'm just looking forward to seeing what they do, really. They're going to be amazing, I think, when they grow into adulthood. So that's just a little bit about the social sustainability, and then the education, as I said, huge amount of material on our website. We have public tours 4 times a year. We run a lot of tours on request, we have a charitable trust that runs our education systems, and that trust has always got an eye on how to get the word out in different ways if people want to hear about it. So just a little bit about how we did it. Basically, Earthsong came about because a group of people got together over time. You know, first it was me, then it was three of us, and then five, and you know, more people, etc. So quite a long, slow period of different people joining. And who wanted to do this? So it wasn't developer driven, it wasn't council or central government driven. It was a bunch of ordinary people who wanted to live in this way, who put in the time and effort to make decisions to put it all together so that it was going to work, you know, financially, legally, design-wise, etc., and got it driven. So that's what co-housing is actually. It's community-led or resident-led development of our own housing. So that was kind of back in 1995, as I said. People joined over time. We found the land that we bought at the end of 1998. It was an organic, an old organic orchard that had been pretty neglected for, you know, a decade or two actually, as the people got older. But it was a good clean site to start with. So we bought that site. We being five of us who put an equal amount for the deposit, and then we wrote a big legal agreement, and by the time we had to settle on the site, there were 26 people who had signed our agreement and pledged different amounts of money to buy the site. So we secured the site. Once we had that site, or once we had the unconditional agreement, boy, development ramped up. Lots of work to do. We spent maybe a couple of years very, very intense development work. So whoever was in the group at that time was very much part of the design process. We worked together to figure out how many houses we could put on and what they were going to look like and what configuration, and etc. All of the how do we get the money and the development finance, what are the legal systems that we need, etc. Very intense work, but just an amazing thing to be part of. At the end of 2000, we started building. This is the old existing orchard house that was there when we bought the land. That's our common house is right there now. It was quite a tough stage one project. So we only built 17 houses to start with because that's how many people we had ready and willing to buy houses off the plans at that stage in the group. It was a bit traumatic, as you'll find out if you read the book, but you know, we got through it. This is just a photo of the builders ramming the rammed earth walls of our houses. Mud and slush through that winter. Various building issues, etc., etc. If you haven't read the book, the builders actually went bankrupt, you know, towards the end of that. So it was a huge issue, but we managed to pull it back on track. This is the inside of our common house, which we built in 2005, and this is the guys ramming the rammed earth for the last set of houses in 2006, and that's two-story rammed earth in that case, which was unusual at the time. And we finished all of the houses and all of the driveways and services and absolutely all of the sort of infrastructure middle of 2008. So it was actually an eight-year building process. And for six of those years, half of us actually lived in the first half while the building was happening in the second half. So it was very long and very intense, but we got through to the end. Amazing bunch of people, you know, just skills and wisdom coming from each of those people, and an incredible determination to get through to the end, which was why we made it, in fact. And very bonded by the end as well. I just thought I'd read you a little bit from my book. So the book that I've written was, it's kind of in two parts which are interleaved. And so every second chapter is the story of our development, from those early years right through to get the end of construction to this point, 2008. And the other half of the chapters are on themes like governance and design and those sorts of things, power and leadership. So I'll just read a little bit from the end. This is the end of stage one, so those first 17 houses, we were getting close to the end. Despite the delays, two buildings neared completion, and we scheduled a major open day for 8th of July to launch two units as show homes. There was frenzied activity during the weeks beforehand by both the builders and by members in order to finish the houses in time. Members of the marketing group worked hard on arrangements for the day, sending out invitations and media kits and organising signage, displays, information stations and the official speakers. The very day before the open day, builders were finishing the pergolas to these houses while paving was being laid below, and members were shifting topsoil, planting trees, cleaning the houses, hanging curtains and arranging furniture. Earthsong started to feel like a village, with houses along pathways, the pond taking shape and members working together. People arrived in droves on the day, walked around the paths and looked through the houses. We had speeches and were presented with Building Research Association Green Home Scheme excellent rating for the houses. In my speech, I said that just as it takes a village to raise a child, it takes a group to build a village, a group of ordinary, extraordinary people. The arrangement of our buildings around common space, very different from the normal rows of houses facing a street with a garage at the front, described our choice to place a higher importance on our relationships with one another than on our relationships with our cars. It was the physical manifestation of the social relationships we'd grown together as we'd worked to build this neighbourhood. And our environmentally responsible construction was not only in addition to our social and cooperative structure, but it existed because of our social and cooperative structure. The two went hand in hand. The day was a great success and we made it onto national TV news that night. So it just gives a little bit of a picture about, I think, the franticness and the intensity, but also the just incredible sense of kind of pride and doing something worthwhile. You know, it was really very important. I'm just going to have a little drink. So as I said, the book has chapters on particular themes, and I just thought I'd just show a few things from two different chapters, just so you get a bit of a feel for the things that are covered. One of the chapters is about designs, design that facilitates community. And I mean, you can't create community with design, but you can sure make it hard for people to feel in community with bad design. And certain design elements really make a difference to people feeling like it's easy to be in relationship with people and that you have a choice. You know, you're not kind of thrust into kind of having to be visible in public. It's about kind of building in lots of layers and having choices. So I've sort of picked out a few key elements that I think describe some of those important things that may not be that visible, really, unless you kind of have pointed out. So it might seem obvious, but I think when you design for people rather than cars, it leads to a very different design layout, actually. And so people-oriented design is what makes an enormous difference at Earthsong, both socially and environmentally. And that's what I kind of mean about the two things really complement each other, and I think you can be a lot more environmentally sustainable if you live in community. They really work well together. So what does people-oriented design mean? Well, I mean, for me it means that, yeah, you design for people, not cars. What works for people is different than what works for cars. Most of our suburban layouts, obviously, they're designed for cars. There's the assumption that the car will drive right up into the house, in fact, into the front of the house these days. And it means that there's very little chance for interaction with neighbours on the way in. And it just makes a lot of things really quite hard. When you leave your car at the edge and you get out of your car and you walk down a pedestrian pathway, it's just so different. This is our main path through the middle. And you can see the kind of life that happens. It's just people walking to and fro from their houses, but you know, there'll be little interactions that happen, and someone will have just have harvested the lemons and you end up taking a lemon home or sort of talking to the kids or whatever. It's just friendly and safe, and it's quiet and peaceful. Really, the stress levels drop when we come down into Earthsong, because we're not always kind of, you know, looking over our shoulders to see if a car's coming up behind us. It takes a lot less land area. So if this was a standard subdivision, this would be the road that, you know, two-lane road, basically, going through to the houses behind. There wouldn't be much greenery that you'd see, and there certainly wouldn't be that kind of life on the streets. Designing for all abilities is really important, I think, because everyone is on wheels at some point in their lives. You know, whether it's the baby in the pushchair, or kids on skateboards, or you know, older people in buggies or walking frames, whatever it is, wheels are fantastic. And if you have a smooth concrete surface with a gentle gradient, it makes it very accessible for everybody. And it also means it's really easy to shift heavy stuff from your car, like the groceries, from your car to your house using a whole different range of trolleys. So really, it's not a disadvantage not being able to drive to your house. And only once in 20 years have I heard anyone complain about not being able to drive to their house, because in so many other ways, there are so many advantages. Occasionally you need an umbrella, but you know.
And we always have trolleys that we can wheel our shopping or children, and we don't need the wheels to push things around.
That's right. As soon as you've got wheels on a hard surface, it's everything's easy. Another important thing is shared facilities. So we have a big common house a big dining room, a very well-stocked kitchen that four or five people can cook in, meeting rooms, children's room, teenagers' room, big shared laundry, a guest room, an office, various things that we decided we wanted in our common house. And having that shared house means that a whole lot of things can happen that are quite different from hosting people in your own house. So one of the things that happens at Earthsong is we have common dinners twice a week. So every Thursday night and every Saturday night, a cooking team made up of four or five neighbours cooks the meal, and the rest of us just come up and have a beautiful meal and go home again and don't feel like we have to do the dishes or anything, you know. So the cooking team does everything once a month, and then the other seven times a month, somebody else does it, and we just get to enjoy it. And it's really that opportunity to get together, to talk, to keep up to date with people, build relationship, and sometimes have really very interesting conversations about the state of the world and what we can do about it. And it's a space where a lot of other things can happen quite spontaneously. So, you know, parties or just morning teas that happen, etc. So having a shared space is very different from being invited to somebody else's house where you're kind of on their terms. Here, we're all neighbours, it's all our home, it's just a home that we share together. Dwellings within a community. So co-housing is much less about the design of the individual home, actually. I mean, they're very nice homes and very well designed and quite compact. But it's more about actually the relationship of those homes to each other. So as well as having well-designed individual homes, they are arranged together around shared common space so that people have enough privacy and enough sense of individuality, but also really easy access to community. And things like lots of layers, as I said before. So you don't step out of your front door and suddenly, my goodness, you're in the glare of 32 houses. You know, you step out your front door, probably into a little kind of garden area, and then you go a bit further and you're in common land, but just within that cluster, and then you go a bit further and you're into bigger common space, etc. And also every house has a front and a back, really. So the front is always has the kitchen overlooking the common space and the front door. The expectation is that you're kind of willing to sort of smile and wave if somebody walks past. On the other side of every house is the more private side, opening into a private garden, and we just have an understanding that if people are in their private yard, they're much less likely to want to interact. And in fact, we often kind of ignore each other because we're just in our private space. Human scale also sounds a little bit obvious, but it's really about what works for people in terms of feeling that sense of belonging and not overpowering and things. And that's to do with the size of the houses, how many stories are built into it, how far apart they are, how far the houses are from the car parks. There's lots of things about scale that just need to be thought through quite carefully about what feels right in this situation. And human scale is also about numbers of people. And so the sort of perceived or the experience that I've read about through a number of different places is that the best window of size is somewhere between maybe 15 households at the lower end and up to kind of 30, 35 at the upper end. Not to say that smaller or bigger can't work at all, it's just that is the kind of window that seems to have the best chance of working well, because there's enough households and enough diversity and difference so that people have different energies at different times and different skills and there's enough people willing to put in the effort at different times. And also, if there's fewer than 15, if somebody is a little bit sort of, offside, I guess, with other people, it matters more because it's kind of smaller and more intense. As it gets beyond about 15 households, it doesn't bring the whole community down, really. There's enough kind of spread that you don't necessarily bump into those people every day or, you know, it just gives a bit more space in relationships. And on the upper end, if it gets too big, you really start losing touch with feeling like you're in a community with all of these people. You lose touch with some of the relationships, and the tendency in a group, in a large group, is that, you know, each of us have a different number of people that we feel comfortable to be in relationship with. And if there's too many, the tendency is just to kind of split a bit and just start interacting with the smaller number of people, and that can lead to division and sort of them and us and just start being a bit holder, a bit harder to hold together in terms of actually we are all in a, in this neighbourhood together, and you know we need to make decisions together, etc. So that was the design, some of the design elements that I've kind of talked more about in the book. One of the other chapters is about governance, community governance and group decision making. And basically as soon as you've got shared facilities or things that you look after together, you need some kind of management system. And often, you know, out there in other situations, it's a elected body or a kind of hierarchical management system. Somebody or some small group make decisions. In cohousing, it's pretty much always some form of consensus decision making. So the expectation is that all of the adults who live together have an equal part in making decisions together about how to manage the whole neighbourhood, how to manage the common facilities, etc. In my observation, there are basically five elements which need to be in place or need to be thought about in order for that to work well. So this is just, this is my experience, and I talk about it more in the book. So the five things that I think need to be in place for consensus decision making to work well. Number one is having a clear and inspirational vision statement. So really right at the beginning, the small handful of people who really kick a project off, get really clear about what it is you're doing together and why really. What are the really fundamental underlying things that you want in this whatever project it is you're working on, and what is the vision that you want to carry through all the way, even though the details are yet to be worked out, and you know that the details will flesh it out. But what is the sort of the thing that will endure through and keep you all on track through that process? So this is the vision that we started with in 1995. Our vision is to establish a co-housing neighbourhood, so that's really important. That co-housing, that described a very well-developed system that described in many books and with a lot of experience around the world. Based on the principles of permaculture, again, a very well-developed system of managing natural environments well. That will serve as a model, and that's the education commitment coming in, of a socially and environmentally sustainable community. So, yeah, quite simple but quite powerful. There are some very sort of powerful things in there that we identified early on and have absolutely remained all the way through as this is what we're doing. And having agreed on this vision with the small group that started it, every new person that came in knew that this was the vision of this group and basically signed up to that vision. So in the future, when we were, further down the track, when we were making detailed decisions about design or whatever, it was always there in the background. So if we got a bit sort of confused, what's the right thing to do here, we could look at this and think, oh yeah, okay, that's what we're doing. All right, so that clarifies, you know, this decision here and made it a whole lot easier. And if people came in who weren't really signed up to that, then, you know, and things got tricky, you could say, well, actually, we were really clear that this is what we're doing. And so, no, we don't actually want to spend a lot of time going down this track because we're doing this, you know. If you want to do something a bit different, you know, we wish you well, but we're doing this. The second one is knowing who your members are, knowing who are the people who have earned the right and made that commitment into the group to be part of that consensus decision making. So I think consensus doesn't work if people don't have a stake in it, because they can say, you know, no, hold off, and have absolutely no consequences to them of holding things up. with our membership process, we've always been self-select, so we've never had a selection process and said, yep, you fit, but no, sorry, you don't. We've never done that. It's always been self-select. But we do have a defined membership process that people go through so that they learn enough about what we were doing at Earthsong to make their informed decision to say, yep, okay, I signed up to that. And an actual threshold, like a step into membership so that we know when they've made that commitment. So the membership process is things like having now that we're built, it's having a tour of Earthsong, having it all explained, our history and agreements and things. They come to a couple of full group meetings as observers and see how we work. They do some reading, the Cohousing book, etc. They're given a buddy, so somebody who has been at Earthsong for some time and is willing to sort of walk beside them and answer questions and that kind of thing. And at a certain point, after about 3 months, usually 3 to 6 months, that person will then be ready, you know, to say, yep, I want to become a member. They pay $100. They are given a little sort of membership welcoming ritual. They're given a set of coloured cards, which is our decision-making method, and they sign the document. They sign our membership agreement, which is like a two-page document which sets out the basics. So signature, you know, ink on paper is important, and a little amount of money I think is important. It's a social contract. And at that point they become an equal member with everyone else, equal part of decision making. So yeah, it's we know who our members are because we know the people that have gone through that process and made that commitment and stepped into, earned the right really to be part of our collective decision making. The third one that I've sort of identified is our communication agreement. So very early on, actually as a result of a conflict we had very early on, we brainstormed and wrote up these communication agreements that we've had ever since as well. We haven't actually ever changed them because they just work so well. And it's really about identifying what we aspire to in terms of how we communicate with each other, what our relationships together. And they're all important, really. Things like confidentiality, so you're not sort of yakking to your friends about something that, you know, you've learned about somebody else. Not interrupting. You know, there's nothing unusual about any of these, really, but they are important. And one of the very important ones is this one here. So I undertake to keep all relationships clear by dealing with any problematic issues directly with the person concerned. So often, you know, in our society, you know, you find people talking to a whole bunch of other people about how annoying this person is, but somehow they never quite get round to having the conversation with that person and sorting it out. That's really quite toxic to neighbourly relations if that happens. And so this is an undertaking about, yes, you might need to download with your best friend about it just to understand it better yourself, but, you know, pretty early on that other neighbour needs to say, look, I can hear you're really upset with that person. Would you like me to come along with you while you sort it out directly with them, or something like that? So it doesn't always happen, but we've all agreed to these to become part of, to become a member. And it just really helps us to stick with keeping our relationships clear, which is important. Number four is our decision-making process and procedures. So I'm not going to go into detail here, but We use a coloured card system to make decisions, so it's just five coloured cards which have different meanings, which helps to facilitate our discussions, and then are used with a different meaning to actually make decisions. So we don't vote, we card decisions. In this case, I think pretty much everyone's holding up a green card, so that means that proposal was a yes, right? It's not always like that. Sometimes there's blues. People hold up a blue, which means not sure really, but you know, I'm happy to go ahead with it. Sometimes there's a red, which is no, I really think this isn't the right way to go, but I'm willing to be part of the process to sort it out. Or an orange means I don't really agree with this, but I won't block it. So there's shades of meaning, and it really, it's a very simple but powerful process to use in any kind of meeting. And, you know, if you're interested to find out more, go on our website and look up coloured card system, and there's a one-page PDF you can download. Any kind of meeting, I think, you'd find it useful. And that is within the context of our structure of how we look after things, which is a bunch of focus groups looking after different aspects of Earthsong, who do the kind of legwork, if you like, and then proposals on anything sort of major come to our once a month full group meetings for decisions. A lot more to say, but that's just, which is outlined in the book, but that's just a little bit of a taste. So does it work? Yes, it works incredibly well. Those systems have really stood us in incredibly good stead through the whole process of developing Earthsong and through the whole process of living there in the years since. So, we come back to the book. And I'm just going to read you one last little bit from the end, and then it would be really great to have, you know, questions and more of a discussion. So this is just from the sort of epilogue, if you like. My voice last. It is increasingly apparent that we are all part of one vast, complex planetary system or organism. And eco-neighbourhoods and eco-villages offer fertile environments to relearn the skills of interdependence and cooperation that will contribute to the health of our beautiful Earth home. Those of us who live in community continue to do work together that is largely uncharted. We are explorers in the territory of respectful and inclusive human relationships. It's not utopia, nor ecotopia. It's much more challenging emotionally and requires us to be constantly self-aware, generous, and open-hearted. Being in connection with others requires great commitment. It's an ongoing journey of self-discovery of ourselves as well as of others. And I just think actually that it's one of the most important work of our time. You know, learning to be in relationship, in respectful and effective relationship with a diverse group of other people, I think is like a homeopathic dose, if you like, that we all need to learn in order to have a flourishing planet. And you know, it might feel like hard work, or, you know, why should I bother when I can go into my single house and close the door and not be bothered? But I think that kind of isolation and myth that we are independent of anyone else is really one of the things that has led us on Earth into this terrible situation where we're just trashing the most beautiful planet that we know about, right? So I really think it's important work, and I just so support anyone who wants to kind of start down that journey and figure out, you know, a more interesting and supportive and flourishing way to live. So Thank you. So, I don't even know what the time is now. What is it?
It is almost 8:00.
Okay, so how long have we got?
Half an hour.
So let's have a conversation. I don't know that we introduced Amanda. She was out at the desk table. So Amanda and I live together and at Earthsong. And do you want to say a little bit about?
Well, one of my many roles, because we have a management system, which Robin hasn't talked about, there's another whole chapter in there. We have a full group, so when you become a member, you effectively join the full group of Earthsong residents. And through that, we have focus groups, which you might join one or two, or if you're really up to it, three. And those groups are such as site management, permaculture, dealing with the gardens, or anything living, family group, membership group, IT group,
common house
group, workshop group. There's lots of different little focus groups where we really nut out, if you like, the issues that we might want to then take to the full membership to make decisions on, or to find out what they all think and gather information. So that's the sort of system of how we all share the work, as well as create a kind of strong network between us in which we're all involved in decisions. So I'm in the membership group, but I'm also in the Earthsong Education Trust. So there's two legal entities to Earthsong. One is the body corporate, because the way that it's been set up legally as a unit titles. So there's the body corp, which we can talk about more if you're interested. But also there's the Education Trust. And that is a legal body. It means that as a trust we can not only host people from outside and fulfill our commitment and our vision statement and in sharing information or bringing speakers in or whatever we might want to do, we also could receive funds because we're a trust to help boost or do other things. So that's a little bit of my contribution, but I'm also here just to answer questions with Robin.
And Amanda's also the buddy coordinator.
I'm also the buddy coordinator. So I do a lot of the people stuff, if you like. And group dynamics is one of the things that we've mentioned and is crucial to and ongoing. It doesn't stop working out consistently, nurturing, holding, not interfering, but letting things unfold, but lots of work. And there's also a facilitation group that we have. So the way that we hold our meetings or our groups is really important. It also always we have minutes, we have agendas that go out, and we have facilitation. And we use the coloured cards in those focus groups, and definitely in the large group. And we have co-facilitators, so there's always someone learning and supporting the main facilitator, or if they have to step out because they want to speak on behalf of a focus group that they belong to, you hand over your role. So we have quite strong structures and boundaries which are essential to enabling the kind of creative process and outcomes which were set up early on. Yeah, I didn't talk about budgeting, but it's a big one. But helping people again be supported into understanding the ways of Earthsong, because it's a big thing. There's 65 people to get to know. That's about 70 now, because we've got so many more new children. And anything from which day to take out the rubbish, when to not do this, when can I pick the fruit off the trees, is there guardians, as well as all our policies and structures like that. There's an endless list that we've created that we cover. And I don't buddy everyone, anyone. Well, I buddy one or two, but I support the buddies to be in that role. So there's a lot of caring about their relationship and helping people fit in.
I have a couple of questions. Do you have a dispute resolution?
Dispute resolution? No.
And if there is something, well, that a lot of people are pressed by and they want to raise an issue, how do you solve that?
Well, they will take it to the appropriate focus group if they have an issue. But you mean when people are in conflict, do you?
Probably.
Or, yes.
Yeah.
There may be quite clear conflict, and that one of the focus groups we have is called Community Life, and part of their role is to be keeping in touch with when there might be difficulties, and you would know that there might be people in that group that you would talk to, and they might offer to facilitate some sort of meeting between those people. And if that doesn't work, there might be someone else who tries, and if that doesn't work, we might go to the group, or we might bring someone in. But one of the things we also have at Earthsong is what we've developed over the last 5 years. It's called the Earthsong Circle. So we have a meeting once a month where there isn't an agenda, there aren't minutes, it's just we meet and we can bring issues about living at Earthsong. So quite a lot of things that might be niggling people can come up there, and then they be aired and they resonate with someone else, or no, that wasn't like that really. And the other thing we do is we always have a check-in at the beginning of each meeting. We always bring ourselves in, so it's really helpful if you've been thinking, oh, have I upset that person? Why aren't they? They're a bit funny with me. What have I done? They're all paranoid or whatever that goes on. And then they tell us in their check-in that their mum's really ill overseas and they're just stressed. And think, oh, God, look, poor things, but it's not me. So all those little things can quite quickly get touched on and sort of eased, if you like, or soothed. And so those check-ins are really important about bringing yourself into the space, as well as maybe helping set the tone, if you like. So there's ways, there's no specific thing.
We'll go ahead.
You mentioned the membership process. At what stage in that process can someone actually buy a unit in this one? And I think the units are traded on the open market.
Yeah.
Do you want to answer that?
No one is prohibited from buying. There is a request specifically that the seller will tell any buyer that there is a difference about buying at Earthsong. You're not just buying a private house, you're buying into a community with shared facilities. So they're asked to notify the membership group, and for anyone interested is offered to come along and meet with the membership coordinators and talk through some of those things. And ideally, they might come to a meeting or two and come to a public tour. But really, it's up to them what happens between the vendor and the purchaser.
So a lot of that process can start if they're seriously interested, but it's not actually until they sign a written, a contract that it really kicks in and they're given a buddy and through that. Was there a related question? Can we just go to this?
Can you tell us a bit more about the body corp and how you managed to buy the land and then make it possible to put all these houses on the land without subdividing it?
Sure. So we went with a unit title ownership model. And unit title is usually for high-rise buildings where you own your flat and you have a share of the stairwell and the lifts and stuff. We applied that to a sort of horizontal community. So every household owns their own unit and little patch of garden. So our unit boundaries are the edge of the garden rather than the edge of the building. And also a 1/32nd share of all the rest of the land and the common house and the workshop and the gardens, etc. So that's how we were allowed to put that, you know, that kind of layout, if you like. If it was a standard lot subdivision, then they probably would have required parking at each house, for instance. What was the other question? How did we buy the land?
You basically answered it.
Yeah.
How tricky was it to get all of that concept past council to get it consented?
Very easy, actually. I mean, the unit title system is a very well-known system. And we went with that partly because that means that individuals can get mortgages from the bank because they have something that they own. Whereas if it was a company title or a cooperative or you know, where you don't actually own something, it's very hard for individuals to get their own finance. each person, excuse me, can also sell to whoever they want for whatever price they want. It's nothing to do with the community, it's between buyer and seller. But as Amanda said, every buyer, the one stipulation that we have really is that everyone who buys into must become a member of Earthsong. And so we have this legal system, the body, you know, the unit title, body corporate. Every house owner is a member of the body corporate, that's how it all works. However, the decision making we do in our way. So actually the admin body corp group is treated as a focus group of Earthsong, and it runs in exactly the same way as the common house management and the site management, etc. group. So while it does all of those legal functions that a body corporate needs to do, the decision making is actually with all of the group, who are renters and buyers, actually, renters and owners. Mm-hmm. So our sort of consensus decision-making system and structure are what we've invented, and it kind of directs the body corp, if you like. Yeah. And the same when we had a company, which was our development company, it's us, the people of Earthsong, the members of Earthsong, who made all the decisions, and the company just carried them out. And similarly with the trust, although the trust also has certain ways that it has to operate, which it does, but you know, for most decisions, it's us, the members of Earthsong, who kind of make the decisions.
I read the American Cohousing book. In there they emphasise repeatedly that it's for their recommendation and the recommendation of many Cohousing residents they interviewed in part of the book, was to build the common house first. And I'm interested that you didn't do that, and maybe it was financial necessity, but we'd like to know about that.
Yeah. I mean, socially, yeah, absolutely. It's great to have the common house first. we couldn't do that. In terms of financing the common house, it's like a little piece of every house's cost went towards the common house. So when we only built 17 houses to start, we didn't have enough money to build the common house at the start. And in fact, the stage one basically paid for all the services, and stage two paid for the common house, really, is, you know, in simplistic terms, is how it worked out. However, we did have a common house because we had that little concrete house that you saw a picture of was our common house for right through until it got demolished in order to build the real common house. And in that year, when Tui House, we called it, when Tui House was demolished and the common house was being built, we actually used one of the built units as our interim common house. So we always did have a common house, it's just that they were small.
And Tui House is now hardcore under the driveway.
Yes, and other things. So it is important to have a common house, really, of some sort, even if it's a big marquee, you know, some place where people can meet, can share food, and kind of build relationship and feel like you're doing something great together. Whoa, where should we go now? Should we go out here? Yeah?
How do you finance common assets, and how do you regulate the use of common assets and the regulation of common assets? And when you think about water,
water? You mean water use? I'll just clarify. Okay, so the question is, how do we finance common facilities, and in particular water, or manage?
Separate question.
Okay. Okay. All right. Okay. So the body, the unit title means that we're each owners of the common house, and because it's a body corporate, we pay body corporate fees. So every year, every unit owner pays money to the body corporate to pay for our shared facilities, and it also pays for all of the house insurance, and it also pays for a chunk of money that goes aside every year for long-term maintenance of common facilities. So that's how we fund it. And we as a group of members decide every year how much we are willing to pay in our body corp fees and what are the things that we want to spend it on in the next year. So again, it's all a very group, you know, decision. And the other question was about services. So I would like to tell you this. So basically, it's very, very cheap to live. Our services are very, very cheap at Earthsong. And that's that has a lot to do with the fact that we have one electrical line charge coming in from the supplier. Every household has a meter, so every household pays for what they use. So there's still that incentive, that sort of direct incentive of you know, being mindful of how much power you use, but we pay that money to the body corporate who pays it to the supplier. So one line charge between 32 houses. It's a bigger line charge than a single house would have, but it's certainly not 32 times, you know, what a single house's line charge would be.
So effectively we distribute it once we bought the electricity in.
That's right.
So all the infrastructure from the public road through our Earthsong is our responsibility.
Yeah.
So we can do what we want.
So the same with water. One water line charge from the council. We distribute it. We pay for what we use to ourselves collectively, which pays. And the same for internet. So, you know, one main internet connection divided up into 32 houses. So the result is that we have incredibly low service charges. So our internet fees are $3 per household per month. You know, for very you know, good volume internet. I had a look at our service charges are public to ourselves, so we all get a spreadsheet every 3 months of what each household has, you know, needs to pay for power, water, internet, parking, blah blah. So it's kind of it's one of the ways that we kind of are accountable to each other. Because if somebody uses a lot of power, it actually will affect all of our power bills because we'll have to have bigger fuses in the transformer, right? So there are, it's just one of, a little example really about, yes, they are cheaper, but they're cheaper, but we still need to be accountable to each other because one person who wasn't careful could bump all our fees up. but anyway, so for a 3-bedroom house, the average service charge per month for power, water, internet, often parking if they've got a second vehicle, is $60 a month.
Does that
include internet? Oh, internet, yeah.
No, rates.
Oh, sorry, rates. No, that's separate.
So which house pays the rates?
Yeah.
So everyone, that's directly between the council and the individual. Right. Yeah. So power, water, and internet is an average of $60 a month, so summer and winter.
Is that all computerised? Someone's job goes through.
Well, sort of. I mean, we self-read our meters, so every 3 months there's a call, you know, an email saying, can you read your meters now and send it in? So we all do that, and somebody compiles it all and works it all out and, you know, kind of puts out the spreadsheet which says how much we each have to pay.
So the area that's expensive is in time. So it's very cheap to live in terms of your pocket. But it does require more time, and living in community is about putting time in, and the more you put in effect, the more you get out as well. So that's a big adjustment for people to make. But that is what it requires. And
in a way, but then
look at what you get.
If you run your own household, you still have to pay your power bill and your water bill and your internet bill. Whereas in this case, it's just one thing that, you know, you just set up a monthly direct credit, and it's all sorted. So
I was thinking of the people who do all the working out.
Oh, yeah.
So everyone who gets into a focus group will have quite a lot of time. Maybe,
so one or two people do that job.
Yeah.
Other people mow the lawns, or they bake the scones for the working bees, or they, you know, there's lots of little tasks that different people take on.
So how often do you meet as a group?
As a full group, we meet once a month, and each focus group meets either once a fortnight or once a month, depending on what's going on. So, if, for instance, we've just had a new influx of members, so that means that membership has got a lot more work to do, so we meet a bit more often, whereas workshop meet once a month, just steady as, really. But yeah, that's how often. And we also have guardianship roles, so everybody has a role to do some sort of cleaning or maintenance in the common house, because it's our shared space. And mine is to sweep the main entrance, and I do that a lot when the leaves are dropping, and not very often through the summer, but it depends. And we also have guardianship roles in the gardens, so we've been trying out tree guardianship. So we've got something like 180, 150 trees, fruit trees, and they have guardians, the big ones particularly, that will fruit and need to be mulched and pruned and things. Yeah. Questions?
In the beginning, these house prices were significantly lower back then.
Yeah.
But anyway, how much of a role played affordability whilst developing the whole project?
So we had a range of people in the group, and you know, some of whom were you know, on a benefit of some kind, or not a lot of money. So we really did try and keep the costs down. However, we were also very committed to environmentally sustainable design, and it's kind of was balancing those things, really. We formed a company which was a non-profit company, so basically the company built, you know, got the development loan, etc., got the houses built, and then sold them to the individual owners at cost, so there was no developer's margin built in. So they were a bit cheaper, I think, than standard houses, although, you know, as I said, we had some disasters as well, which kind of bumped the price up. I think they were probably comparable with a similar sized house built of normal materials in the suburbs. But what we got was really good quality solid materials, solar water heaters, you know, share of common space, etc. So I think they were good value, but they weren't, they were never kind of low cost housing. Yeah.
Is it the same now?
Yeah.
And they sell for market value?
Well, it's really hard to tell, you know, what is market value. A three-bedroom house that sold recently was what? I think 900. I think it's got up to 900,000.
Yeah, it was about 850 6 months ago, and now there's another one that sold about 900.
Yeah. So I think they are still cheaper. Well, you know, quite well cheaper, really, than a similar house, even in our area, which is not that close to town. But so much better built, you know, share of common facilities, etc. And I think they are still slightly below market rate, because not everybody, you know, there's a much smaller market for them, and people have to want to live in closer, you know, cooperation with the neighbours.
Is it
okay
to ask about rates?
Rates? The rates are about $2,500, I think, a year for a three-bedroom house at the moment.
Cheaper than Carterton. We're famous for having the most expensive rates in the
really?
Country.
You had a question?
Along the lines of this, like, accessibility and affordability, and like with your experience and with the current state of the price of housing.
Yeah.
And the price of building, like, I have a few questions around that. I'll just quickly try and find them. So, in the Ramnooth builds, did you use earth from the land mass?
No. because you need a certain type of earth that works, which has a range of particle sizes from small to big, blah, blah. So we're on clay.
Okay.
So it wasn't suitable, but it was trucked in from not that far away.
Okay. And so with your experience in that, and say, for example, there was a group of people about to do a project like this again, but really driven towards, obviously, this, but also this accessibility, like a single income family in the current state of things,
yeah,
with the cost of building, like, do you think this, it's accessible? Like, do you think it's doable to a similar standard, or does there need to be sort of big change? Yeah, will we need to sacrifice in that way?
So really, I think it's very hard to build cheaply without building cheaply, if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
Like it's kind of cheaper, lower quality materials. The sorts of things you could look at more is size. So definitely smaller is cheaper. However, that also has limitations because you still need a kitchen and a bathroom and everything. It's quite a complex question, but you know, theoretically, building a bunch of houses which are very similar and close together and one contract should be cheaper. However, it may not be, depending on the kind of materials you use. If you go outside the norm like we did with unusual materials, rammed earth, solid untreated timbers, etc., you know, no treated timber on site, no tannelized, no even boric internal framing, it's all untreated timber. So things like that. It has implications. So one thing it means is that it is less tried, you know, so there are, I guess, greater opportunities for something to go wrong because it's not so so known. However, some of the best known construction materials have gone badly wrong, haven't they? You know, leaky buildings, sheets, thingies, whatever. So, yeah. It also means that you limit your range of builders that you can get to build it, because obviously you need suppliers who are able to supply those unusual materials, you need builders who are used to working with them, etc. So you don't go to sort of the market, you know, and have a bunch of different builders to choose from who can tender, you know, and you choose the cheapest price. Basically, with rammed earth and untreated timbers, there was really one or, you know, maybe two that we builders who had the capacity to do that when we started. And so it does kind of tie you into those relationships, and that's not necessarily a bad thing either, but it means that, you know, it's a very complex question.
Yeah,
so,
just to say, and co-housing doesn't have to be eco-building. That's just the choice that they made at Earthsong.
Yeah.
So there's all other ways to do co-housing, from blocks of flats to revamped factories to out in the country to in the city. I mean, there's different ways.
So
eco-building's another thing again.
Yeah, exactly. And short answer is it is really hard to reduce the cost of a decent house without reducing the quality. I'll just finish while I've got this train of thought, sorry. However, there are ways that people helped each other into houses. So we had older couples whose kids have left home and they've worked their lives and they had, you know, a bit of extra money, who kind of paired with young families to kind of help them in, just because we had that, you know, they knew each other by then and trusted each other, etc. So working as a group does help to unlock different ways of helping each other. And I guess the other thing is that if you can afford to buy the house in the first place, running costs are a lot cheaper, and you know, you'll never lose that money, I don't think. You know, it's always, I in my experience, a stretch. You know, the houses are always too expensive, but if you can manage to stretch to make it work, unless we do have a big housing crash, you know, in a few years' time, it kind of, you know, it eases out, and you don't lose on it. Sorry, back to you.
Does it worry you that the houses are built out of untreated timber? Because if we tried to build a house here out of untreated timber, we wouldn't get a
We had to fight pretty hard for it, for stage two, because by then the whole leaky building thing was rolling out. But one thing is that the houses breathe. So we haven't got any kind of plastic layer, waterproof layer between inside and outside. So moisture from inside can actually find its way through and evaporate off. It doesn't get trapped. It's when it gets trapped.
Borer doesn't breathe very much.
Sorry?
Borer doesn't breathe very much. They have a great feast on those.
Borer. Well, borer generally are more of a problem where the timber gets damp and stays damp.
But we also oil the houses on the outside, and they are, there's a pump site.
Yes.
What sort of timber is the outside of the house?
And the other thing is, well, so this is Lawson cypress and macrocarpa and western red cedar at different times. The way we got building consent for the later houses, so that's kind of 2005-06, was we actually used heart Lawson cypress framing, which we had to work hard to find the documentation, but did eventually find a study which said that was equivalent to H3.1, I think it was, or 3.2. So, yeah. So we have gone outside the norm in order to avoid treated timber.
You have another question?
It's just rules.
Sorry?
You can use untreated Douglas, but it's just rules.
Yeah.
You wouldn't be able to do some of your roof joints and stuff like that.
Yeah, you can't do bottom plates, I think, with Douglas fir. Well, seven of our houses have Douglas fir framing because it was allowed at that stage, but, you know, then they didn't.
But it's kind of possible now.
Yeah. There's ways around it, but you have to work harder at it, yeah.
The other question?
Yeah, I wondered how the renting, so you mentioned that some people are renting, how that works?
Every house is owned by somebody, and some of those owners choose to rent out their houses, and we've always been fine with that because it helps us with our, you know, with diversity. Some of our young families have actually started out as renters and then people, you know, have found a way to buy in, for instance. And we've never made any distinction between renters and owners in terms of decision making. There, you know, if you live at Earthsong, you become a member and you're an equal part of everything.
And one of the things that, because Earthsong was the first of its kind in New Zealand, they could only finance it by everyone buying something, basically. But ideally, you might get a council who will buy into a house or two, or you might have enough money in the body corporate to buy a flat or two so that you could provide more rents, really, which is what happens in other countries. A lot of co-housing is also social housing in Denmark, for example, because there's a relationship where the government provides, basically, some way that people can be more
community. Yeah, I really like the mixture.
Yes, but we couldn't do that, but other co-housing in Dunedin have tried, but they've had some real trouble, haven't they, with that?
Which one, sorry? The council buy-in?
The council buy-in, but there was another area, anyway. It's another story.
It's a whole other story. So there was one more question over in the corner there. I think we've only got time for one.
Just check.
Yeah?
Oh, just in your experience, have you had any dealings with co-housing with people using tiny house on wheels? You know, because more affordable, but in the same sort of co-housing situation.
I've heard that idea a lot, and there's lots of people who would like that to happen. And I think it definitely has potential, and if those people, if there was a common house, some sort of shared facility, it would make living in a tiny house work a whole lot better, and you'd still have the space to work together. I guess one thing you'd have to pay a bit of attention to is how permanent those people are, and if they're moving on every couple of years, then it's gonna take a lot of effort to kind of keep a sense of community.